Hello and welcome to Bedhead Books. Today we're going to be looking at The Ox. This is the authorised biography of John Entwistle. It's written by Paul Rees, who is a music journalist who has previously written a book about Robert Plant that I happen to have read. So if you don't know who John Entwistle was, he was the bass player in a little band called The Who. This book is actually partially formed of notes that Entwistle had made in the 1990s for his own memoir that never came to fruition, sadly, because Entwistle died in 2002. And so there were, by Paul Rees's reckoning, there were about four chapters that Entwistle had written and had prepared that he could have used in his version of events. And so from a musical perspective, the book largely takes a look at the importance of Entwistle's influence and particularly his training and his background and how this fed into The Who, how he was able to read music and understand music a little bit better than the other three, and he was able to arrange particularly brass sections for some of The Who's best songs, if you think of 515, a couple of Entwistle's own compositions such as My Wife. You will often find that bass players are one of the most proficient, talented members of any band. For reference, you can see another John, that being John Paul Jones of Led Zeppelin, who was an experienced session arranger, could pretty much play any instrument you put in front of him. There's an interview with Pete Townshend where he suggests that Entwistle's proficiency on the bass was due to the fact that he'd had a background playing trumpet and French horn. What Entwistle would have been doing on the trumpet and the French horn, he would have been doing this, because these are the finger movements when you press the buttons on a trumpet or a horn. And if you take those movements and invert them like that, you're using the same muscles that you would use to play a bass, which explains why another of Entwistle's nicknames was Thunderfingers. The book does also dig into Entwistle's career as a solo musician, the various bands and projects that he attempted to put together outside of The Who when they were on some of their more extended hiatuses. And Rees draws up an interesting quote from Keith Alton, who had done publicity for The Who several times. He had said that while he enjoyed Entwistle's first solo album, he did find that the way that it was made and the way that it was presented was a lot more in line with what a musician would want to listen to, rather than the general masses, who were of course the people who were buying The Who's records. If I'm talking about Entwistle's solo work, I should mention that an awful lot of it put him out of pocket. And another thing that is remembered quite a lot about Entwistle is his spending habits. He was incredibly extravagant. He bought things that arguably he didn't need. And on some occasions, he was very generous to the people around him. Bill Kerbishley, who took over as The Who's manager in the 1970s, recalls looking at a painting in a hotel in the States that he was very fond of. And it had like a $150,000 price tag, something like that. And so Kerbishley couldn't afford it. When they got home from the tour, Kerbishley found that the painting had been delivered to his house, and Entwistle had actually bought it for him. Now, of course, this is also something that he did an awful lot of for his wife, Alison, and his son, Christopher. And Entwistle does not have the greatest reputation as a person in his private life. So, to an extent, I suppose you could argue that his extravagant spending and buying gifts for people was one of his ways of showing love and showing that side of himself that he was not generally very keen on doing. He was generally a very subdued kind of person. And although he was quite passionate about his family, he was passionate about his family when he was there, or so this book makes it seem. When he was off on tour with The Who, he was doing all manner of drinking and drug taking, and obviously in the 70s, when Keith Moon was still around, they really became partners in crime, and Entwistle, you know, could allow parts of himself to come out in Moon's company that he previously wouldn't have done. So yeah, outside of touring, Entwistle could get very bored and restless with a normal life.
It's like soldiers that used to go out to war and come back and just couldn't identify with like normal life anymore. When you come home, it's like, I can't take this like normal system.
Because Townsend was such a prolific songwriter, he obviously got a huge chunk of royalties for this, and because of this, it meant Townsend spent an awful lot of time in his studio at home recording, coming up with new ideas, and was less inclined to go out on tour. So like I say, there are many areas of this book that don't hold back when it comes to the portrayal of Entwistle's personal and private life. And certainly something that you may or may not know about The Who is that the four of them never had the most simpatico relationship. They were often arguing and fighting. Certainly the four of them were from a particular generation, no pun intended, but you know, in post-war Britain, the children of that era wanted to communicate with their parents a lot more than they had done in the past, but their parents were still the very strong stoic spirit, and I think that in some way, you know, was instilled in all of the kids who grew up around that time period.
Practically everybody that I know that I grew up with, if they were wild and crazy and weird or in a band, the chances were that they had some weird sh- when they were kids. We all had exactly the same experience. You know, when you went to Grandad and you said, what do you think made the Germans do that? You go, oh, I'll talk about it. Oh, I'll talk about it. Oh, I can't go,
you know, arguably it's something that a lot of us still do possess nowadays, and it's something our parents had, but we're able to kind of, I don't know, the world's a bit more open, I suppose, than it would have been in the days where, you know, men were men and they act like men, you know? So there are rather a lot of books out there about The Who. I could not list them all here, but there are a few, and this is the latest edition, that focus on an individual member of the band. So I think the first book that did this properly was Dear Boy, which is about Keith Moon. There's also a biography about Townsend. Townsend, of course, wrote his own autobiography in 2012, and Daltrey wrote his autobiography in 2018. And so I say, this is the latest addition to the batch of books dedicated to an individual member of the group. And I generally think it's perhaps more interesting to put them all together rather than just have one book about The Who, because like I say, there are so many, it's difficult to choose. There are not too many revelations in this book. There are a few surprises. There are some nice, amusing stories. There's one story about an occasion where Keith Moon got drunk and passed out it was probably the Hyatt House Hotel, and Entwistle had to look after him. And so what he did was he dragged Keith Moon back to his suite, and Entwistle trashed the room. And when Moon woke up in the morning, he thought he'd done it. And so he had to pay for the damages. But the book is still very solid though. So if you are a Who fan, I would recommend you check this out. And I'm going to give The Ox a 6 out of 10. Thank you very much for watching, and remember, don't judge this book by its cover.
My life in jeopardy, murdered in cold blood is what I'm gonna be. I ain't been home since Friday night, and now my wife is coming after me. Give me police protection, gonna buy a gun so I can look after number one. they got a black belt judo expert with a machine gun.